So, I would like to say welcome to our third speaker this afternoon, Astrid Nonbo Andersen, who is a postdoc researcher at the Danish Institute for International Studies. Is that right? Yeah. She holds a PhD in intellectual history and has done research on Danish Danish points and relations to its former colonies and to colonial history, but also on ideas of the colonial past in the Virgin Islands, for instance. And she's presently working on a research project related to Greenland. But now she's going to talk about the points on the Danish West Indies. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you. And I would also like to thank the organizers. I wasn't able to make it to the session in the US Virgin Islands either. But I'm happy to speak today. My speech is also, picking up from Bolette's speech, is also on newspapers, as you can see. And this time it is Danish newspapers mainly, or only. And I'm going to start out right away with this quotation from this year. It's the Prime Minister's centennial speech from March 2017. When I was a child, the popular Danish story about the West Indies was a romantic one. Exotic islands, peaceful coexistence. I even remember the tales of the Danish king who was the first in the world to ban the slave trade. A pioneer of humanity, we were told, a hero. But most of you were told and lived a different story, the true story, a story of how slavery continued after the ban, how too often conditions only improved on paper, and how many of your ancestors continued to suffer. The true heroes were the men and women who stood up to the injustice. This speech was the culmination of a longer debate in Denmark on whether or not Denmark should use the occasion to apologize for slavery. A heated debate took place in Denmark several months prior to Transfer Day. But this was not only the culmination of that debate, but also the culmination of a much longer process of remembering colonialism in Denmark, which goes all the way back to the days when the islands were transferred to the US. The Danish colonial engagements around the world have never taken up more than a marginal space when the history of Denmark has been told. But memories of the Danish West Indies have never disappeared entirely from Danish memorial culture. However, it's often been characterized by a certain post-colonial nostalgia, which avoids dwelling on the violence with which both the enslavement and the colonial project in general was enforced. Now, the interesting thing about this Transfer Day speech, there are more interesting things about it, but what is interesting in this context is that the Danish Prime Minister actually reflects on two dominant tendencies which can be found in Danish representations of Danish West Indies. And that is, first of all, what we could call the nostalgic narrative, which often focuses on the very last period of Danish rule in the Danish West Indies, and which also tends to focus on the ban of the slave trade in 1792 and von Scholten when retelling the history of the enslavement. This is a narrative that often insists that the Danish colonial engagement was of a more humane and mild kind than that of other European powers. But there's also another narrative, the critical narrative, I would call it. It's one that often criticizes exactly the lack of knowledge of the colonial past in the Danish public, and which also dwells on the enslavement and the violence of it. These two tendencies have coexisted since at least the 1960s, and still coexist. And my aim today is to give you an overview of how Danish perceptions of the Danish West Indies have changed over the course of the 20th century and up until today. And not least to show how the perceptions were impacted by contemporary political events around the world. I'm focusing on how the subject was treated in Danish newspapers at important round number anniversaries, that is, Transfer Day, but also Emancipation Day. I'll start out in 1948, which is the centennial of Emancipation Day. This event took place in the shadow of the Second World War, but also at the onset of the Cold War. At this time, the Danish Social Democratic Party had transformed from an internationally oriented class-based party to a nationally focused popular party. During the war, the Social Democratic Party was not able to keep up with the social reforms that it had promised prior to the war. Danish communists were arrested in June 1941, and the consequence was that the Communist Party experienced a wave of popularity that continued well after the war ended. The Social Democratic government in post-war years fought to win back the favor of the working class. And they did that not by emphasizing class solidarity on an international scale, but rather national solidarity. Because of the fact that the latter agenda had already, or the former the class solidarity agenda had already been won by the Communist Party. Centennial Emancipation Day was made into a year-long celebration by US Governor William H. Hasty in the US Virgin Islands, but that was not the case in Denmark. There was no official commemoration that took place. It only attracted a little attention in the public media. Memories of Denmark and the former tropic colonies in general was treated in both public and scholarly works at this time, was treated within a largely uncritical narrative, which was infused with a good deal of post-colonial nostalgia and also sometimes overt racism. And the dominating tendencies in all newspaper articles, except the communist paper that didn't even mention the date, was that gradual reforms had always been preferred over revolution. And this, again, of course, reflects the fact that the immediate political background was this widespread fear of communism. So if we look at the conservative newspaper, Berlingske Tidende, it bemoaned the emancipation as an erroneous deviation from the controlled transition otherwise followed. According to the newspaper, Governor von Scholten's intention had been to gradually transform the enslaved into a civilized workforce, which was not yet ready to stand on their own feet, in quotation marks. And I have one quote from Berlingske Tidende. The event at St. Croix 100 years ago, which is now celebrated with festive commemoration, rashly and senselessly brought a calm development to an abrupt end. Neither on Danish nor West Indian side can the memory of this event be the source of pride. They mark a disgraceful date, which seen in historic hindsight, has been attributed with progress, which is rather stabbed in the back. Now, this was the conservative press, but you see something like it in the social democratic press. It's describing the period prior to 1848, and it describes the relationship between planters and enslaved as a good patriarchal relationship between planters and slaves, and it, that is the Danish West Indies, was without doubt also the place in the West Indies where the slaves had the best conditions. And then it continues, a few places had been ravaged, that is during the revolt in 1848, but overall the revolt had taken a benign course, which without doubt was due to the tolerable conditions most Negro slaves had lived under. So this was a social democratic press. The centennial, we have to note, also took place just 1 year after the Nuremberg Tribunal had concluded its work, proving the existence of the mass extermination camps in Nazi Germany to the outside world. At this time, a few German Jewish intellectuals, such as Hannah Arendt and Adorno and Horkheim, and also W.E.B. Du Bois that we heard about just before, had already drawn parallels between slavery and the Holocaust. There's a slight comparison appearing actually in that large book, Our Tropic Colonies, or Gammel Skogkolonier, where the historian Biebig calls the Danish West Indies during enslavement a gas chamber. But that is kind of the only parallel drawn. So this type of comparison was far from dominating in 1948. And that probably has to do with the fact that the vast majority of Danish Jews had been brought to safety in Sweden, but also that anti-German sentiments in Denmark probably blocked any parallels between the two. Instead, the experience of having just been occupied by an all-powerful Germany sparked nostalgic fantasies of times when Denmark had been able to fight back. And that created imperial imaginations that in the scale, in light of the small-scale realities and the 1943 rescue of the Jews probably seemed innocent. So now I jump on to the 1960s, that is 1967, which is the 50th anniversary of transfer. Late 60s were marked by a number of global events. The violent struggles for independence in Africa, Asia, and Latin America came to shape a new discourse on anti-imperialism, even in the West. At this time, the fear of communism has also already culminated, ending with McCarthyism, which after that period had been transgressed, renewed for a new critique of US foreign policies. This time, the youth movement in Germany had also started questioning the involvement of older generations in the Nazi reign. And at this time, the Vietnam War became part of a mass movement of global solidarity with the Third World, and which also tied on to the civil rights movements led by African Americans. So this is kind of the background of Transfer Day 67, and this sparked new attention to the former Danish West Indies and the Danish press. So whereas in 1948, the press had agreed on an overall tribute to the gradual reform period of Enslavement, in 1967, the press was dramatically divided. So we have on the one hand the conservative press, which still held on to the uncritical post-colonial nostalgia, but on the other hand, we have a left-wing center press which launched severe attacks on the Danish engagement in slavery, debunking the nostalgic narrative and also criticizing the sale of the territory in 1917. Berlingske Tidende again ran a few short articles covering the Transfer Day celebration, often with titles that were dripping of post-colonial nostalgia, such as "At the Jubilee in Our Old Tropic Colony" or "The Danish flag again flies high in St. John." None of these articles mention poverty, slavery, or rebellions. And the readers left with the impression that the islands were wealthy and well-managed during the Danish rule. An article in Jyllandsposten, another conservative or right-wing press, affirmed the continued close ties between Denmark and the US Virgin Islands, again emphasizing rich heritage of Danish culture lived in the islands, and I have one quotation from that. "The love of the old country reappears time and again. The people here who lived during the Danish rule have always held the memory of that past in high esteem. The islands have become wealthy during the years that have passed, and though the wealth has been created during the American rule, it has roots in Danish culture and Danish society." This is in striking contrast to the social democratic paper Aktuelt, which attacked the very same version of the past. "These days we celebrate the parting at home as well as in the islands. We are left with a somewhat melancholic feeling that it was with sorrow the native population said goodbye to the cozy little country that had cared so well for them. 250 years of a model rule was over. The problem is, it's not true." And so the rest of this article goes on emphasizing the racism of Admiral Kronholm, who was the last Danish governor of the islands, who is blamed for being part of the reason. He's blamed for being an overt racist, but also for being part of the reason why the majority of the population had been held in deep poverty during the last part of the Danish rule. The anniversary also sparked memories of slavery in the civil left and left-leaning press. So the Transfer Day exhibitions in the Town Hall of Copenhagen was accused of being abrasively sunshiny. The reporter criticized the silence on enslavement. The reporter even called for something resembling an official apology. Yeah, and here's the quote from this article. It's talking about the speakers that were opening that exhibition. None of the speakers found reason to regret that Denmark had also been engaged in the slave trade, and that these islands had been used to exploit stolen and bought manpower, that the Danish ban on slavery was not at all something we have a special reason to pride ourselves on. The communist newspaper Land og Folk described the social conditions in the Danish West Indies as, I quote, appalling all the way up until the transfer. It emphasized the revolutionary aspect of emancipation and rejected that it was von Schotten who had put slavery to an end. It also went on to tell that the conditions of the West Indian working class deteriorated after 1848 and saw this as a story of that continued all the way up to 1917. And it especially focused on the poor conditions of the working class. That was the reason why most West Indians greeted the transfer to the US. So all in all, what we see in 1967 is that this is the first year in which an explicit critique of Danish colonialism is openly vented in the public. The critique on the left in Denmark is especially inspired by the growing criticism found in the youth movement, Germany especially. It is also very much inspired by a class analysis thwarting the national unity found in the we identity, which is often used in the conservative press. And so several of the left-wing articles pay close attention to the union leader D. Hamilton Jackson and his fight for rights against the Danish authorities. So now I'm jumping to the 90s, and here I take 1992, which is the 75th anniversary of transfer, and the 1998, which is the 150th centennial of emancipation, and I take them a bit together because they say something about the 90s. In 1992, the Cold War is over. So the fall of the Berlin Wall, the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the turn away from Maoism to a technocratic government in China, all in all, meant that the serious ideological alternatives to liberal democracies backed by a major state had disappeared at this time. And that meant that liberals and conservatives saw this as an ultimate proof that the values and principles of liberalism had prevailed, or as expressed in Francis Fukuyama's thesis, this was the end of history. So with the former ideological enemy gone and a left that had lost much of its drive and credibility, proponents of liberal democracies could now safely open chapters of their own past that had otherwise been closed in the ideological showdown during the heydays of the Cold War. For the 1992 Transfer Day and 1998 Emancipation Celebration, the end of the Cold War seems to have had at least two visible effects. First of all, especially after 1998, a tide of public apologies for historical injustices was sweeping through the world. And secondly, the critique of colonialism, which was previously only found on the left, had at this time been absorbed by the right. The latter can be seen in the conservative press. Seven Transfer Day articles in Berlingske Tidende from March and April 1992 focus on the enslavement and comments on the sale of the islands as a second form of trade with human beings. I have one quote of that. Von Schotten is the only Dane still remembered, and that is not surprising given the fact that the Danish authorities apparently had forgotten that slavery had been abolished 69 years earlier when they sold the inhabitants to the USA. They were in fact never asked if they wanted to become American. Music and color cover the fact that it is a trade with human beings that is being celebrated. So some of the articles in Berlingske Tidende makes parallels between colonialism and new exploits in the form of the tourism industry that Danish companies still benefit from. But the critical line did not entirely replace the post-colonial nostalgia. Instead, they kind of merged into a new form, So in which the acknowledgement of historical injustices were kind of domesticated and fitted into a new narrative. We can see this in another quote from Berlingske Tidende. Even though Denmark led the way in ending the slave trade, and an entire population was sold without being asked, the question remains if Denmark at the time of the sale had a real choice. Had it been today, Denmark was most likely would not have sold the islands, but instead tried to develop a home rule similar to the one in Greenland or the Faroe Islands. The sale of the West Indian islands must be considered the closure of Denmark's role as a colonial power. While honoring the truth, it has to be said that Denmark's past as a colonial power is a less proud chapter in its history. We were hardly worse than other colonial powers, but not much better either. So you may already notice here that the fact that Greenland actually continued to be a colony all the way up to 1953 is not there, but it also shows that this kind of merging of two narratives, that on the one hand, it tells that this is not a proud history, we were not better, but it also stresses that we were not worse than the others. And had it been today, we would have done differently, again showing that at this time, conservatives and liberals were able to see their past in a different way. So 1998 marked the 150th anniversary of emancipation. And the dominating question in this at this time was the question of whether or not the Danish government ought to issue an apology. Again, the former divides between left and right had disappeared. You find arguments pro and contra an apology in all newspapers. Those these arguments fall in two groups. Those, on the one hand, that think that the case was obsolete, and those, on the other, who think that apologizing would be the morally right thing to do. In group one, I've chosen to call it the Viking argument. You find a variety of arguments, but one of the more outstanding is the Viking argument. And by pointing out that the Viking raids, this argument seeks to ridicule claims on apologies or other forms of regress for the past as absurd. So from 1998 and onwards, this has been one of the most common recurrent arguments whenever this question is being debated. And I'm going to give you just one example of it. So personally, I think we should start off by apologizing unreservedly to the Norwegians. And here I not only think of hundreds of years of Danish supremacy, which first and foremost consisted of crude exploitation of original Norwegian qualities such as severity, pomposity, national chauvinism, greediness, and patterned sweaters. Wow. Moreover, for Viking raids in England, the War of 1849, and to Greenlanders and Faroe Islanders. But in group two, you find a pattern of comments which is attacking Danish national self-righteousness from a quasi-moral standpoint, revealing inconsistencies in the Danish self-portrait. And note that this argument is also in Jyllands Posten. Denmark has still not issued an official apology for the barbaric act that forced hundreds of thousands into slavery. We Danes are usually the first to reproach the Americans for their atrocities against Native Americans, and we look on the Spanish genocide in South America with contempt. But as a typical expression of Danish self-righteousness, we are convinced that we have never been that evil ourselves. So these arguments, pro and contra, can be found in all parts of the political spectrum, and this, of course, indicates that the question in reality was not perceived as a real threat to anything at this point. So it has moved from a political, ideological discussion in the 40s and 60s, and has at this point become a moral issue. So whether I'm in favor or not of an apology, most agreed that the question did not have much to do with contemporary Danish society, or issues related to global justice, or the persisting socio-economic problems in the US Virgin Islands. But, on the other hand, because there was no longer a need to explain away the Danish involvement in slavery as previously, And there was also more will to dispel old myth and national illusions. We had this debate. The apology debate was heated, but it was still moderate when compared to contemporary debates on the Cold War or the Danish resistance movement during the Second World War, which have both divided the Danish public generally into two much more irreconcilable blocks. And now I have 5 minutes, 4 minutes left, so I'm jumping on to today. 2017. The year is not over. I have not finished my studies on the public debate this year, of good reasons, and I haven't had much time to it either. But I can say a few things about the tendencies right now. Again, if we look on to the world situation, we have a situation right now of accelerated globalization, which shows consequences to the stability both amongst and within states. We have a right-wing populism, Trumpism, Brexit movement going on. We have the climate changes. We have a crisis of liberalism. We have a crisis in public debate, fake news, fragmented media, public debates taking place in silos, and we have a fatigue of politicians. And all of that creates a lot of insecurity and a lot of debates internally within the different spectres. So we have new discussions, both left, right, and center right now, and these are, of course, again, impacting the view of the past. But they're also mirroring the general situation, which is there's no clear picture right now. Rather a number of internal discussions. In Denmark, Danish West Indies and the history of the Danish West Indies has never been more intensely covered by the media than during this winter and spring. But what is new, we find on the conservative side, we still find the nostalgic narrative. But what is new this year is that we have a handful of Virgin Islanders, especially activists and artists, that have taken place or have taken part in the public debate in Denmark. And we have a much higher number of Danes, including journalists, that have visited the islands than ever before. The media coverage was again dominated by the apology discussion, and many of the arguments, as I just said, reappear. We still find the Viking argument. So the two dominating tendencies, a critical and a nostalgic one, with a lot of different ones in between, is still visible. But if we take the critical line first, this line was much more dominant in 2017 than ever before. You see that in an active interest in both books, textbooks and museum exhibitions, TV documentaries that showed an interest in representing the enslaved and West Indians as human beings with individual agency and not just as commodities, as was often the case in older books and textbooks. And also a big wish to highlight the cruelty of enslavement. And also a few of these representations take an interest in the US word and as of today, and some details of the transfer date. The nostalgic narrative you can also still find. You find it in travel ads, especially. You also find it in TV travel shows focusing almost entirely on specific Danish cultural traits left in the US Virgin Islands, which often give an impression that the islands remain largely Danish if you haven't been there yourself. However, you also see new perspectives in the apology discussion. On the far left, we had Enhedslisten, the party most to the left, which favored an apology. But it was not a point of view that's shared by all members of the party. And I'm just having one quote from this year showing that. This is a critique of Enhedslisten. Gone is the class perspective. Left is a diffuse nationalism, claiming a larger we that can inherit guilt. Need I say that this kind of nationalistic thinking is potentially life-threatening? We saw the result in the 1990s when Serbs exterminated Muslims. The claim for an apology is first and foremost an expression of the wave of identity politics pouring into the European left from the US. Whereas previous waves of identity politics aimed at making all groups equal and remove difference and oppression, the new wave creates divides and differences based solely on this complexion. That is a new type of race. And again, this comment mirrors a larger chasm in the European left between, on one hand, a friend that is primarily occupied with identity politics, and another one, which is more focused on class solidarity and economic equality. I have one moment left. So what also happened here in this year was that the populist right made sure to allocate public funds to the centennial commemoration, but also insisted that it pass no consequence to the present. And so we also had a discussion on whether or not the word nea or negro is still a neutral word. And we also have, if we look at the liberals, social liberals that have otherwise always been opposed to the question of an apology, suddenly changing position. Which again shows that there's really a lot of confusion taking place and a lot of renegotiations within these three ideological spectres. Yeah, I could talk more. I'm going to end here. Just saying one thing is, we can see a lot of things happening, but there's one thing that's safe to say, and that is that public perceptions of the past will change again and again. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm sure that there are comments or questions. Or not. Okay, there is one there.
Thank you. Thank you for a wonderful presentation. I really admire your work into these social memories. And my question goes on how we preserve these social memories, like as a heritage, if we should, and how we should do it. Because as you may know, this UNESCO convention has focused more into like this intangible heritage. And this, you could say, could be an intangible heritage with many arguments in between. Do you think it should be preserved? And if so, how should it be preserved?
I'm not sure if I understand the question. What should be preserved?
So if you see this this discussion as an intangible heritage and how we discuss the social memories of the past, and if you see, should I make myself more clear?
So if the social memory and the debate should itself be seen as a kind of heritage?
Yeah, exactly.
I've never thought about that. That is interesting. I will have to reflect on that. But it's, I mean, when we're talking about social memories, and I use exactly that term instead of collective memory in the plural, I like to talk of social memories exactly as I show that you always have a spectre of different opinions. At some points, some are more dominating than others, but at other points, it's other. But you always have a discussion going on. And the reason why it's important to stress that there wasn't just one way of thinking at any point in any time of the history. I don't know if you should preserve it and how you would preserve it. I mean, I've been writing about it, but I think it's interesting to know at least that instead of if you believe that it was always thought of as the same thing until today, which is sometimes the impression that you have when I speak to journalists, that you sometimes meet that, why have we never talked about this before? And I'm so, well, there was actually a lot of discussion on this 50 years ago, but you need to go into the archives to find out. Sorry, my voice is
gone. Thank you.
Yeah. As maybe some of you know, I'm really a collector kind of person, and I have collected newspaper cuttings from Danish newspapers about the Virgin Islands. I have also inherited some collections from other people, so I have quite a lot from the 50s as well. You know, Astrid. I have put them in folders. I have 13 folders with newspaper cuttings. Number 13 folder started the 1st of January, and very soon I have to go into a new one because this year the newspapers exploded in writing about the islands, and it's all kind of subjects. And I don't have everything. I just have what I collect myself and what people give me. So I can assure you that is absolutely right. There is this new explosion of interest in what is in discussion about the islands, which anyway, I don't know. I preserve it. So to say that task, yeah.
I have a question. I was wondering whether you can trace any sign that this discussion about the history of the Virgin Islands and Denmark is more sort of connected to or discussed in connection to also the ideas of Danish relations to Greenland. Because as I see, well, now I'm in the National Museum and we're working on this new exhibition on Danish colonial history, where we discuss both West Africa, India, West Indies, and Greenland. And my impression is that actually I meet people who are offended that we discuss Greenland and the Caribbean in the same sort of fora. And I think Greenland has been up this year too in the press, but do you have any ideas of that, comments on that?
I can't say any definitive thing about that, but I actually looked for it while I did the study for this. I also looked at how Greenland was covered at this time, and in the article I wrote, I think I have a few examples of that, because that is a parallel discussion, of course, of relevance. But it's not always, especially when it comes to the apology discussion, if that is the main focus, Greenland is left out. And I think mainly that is because the question of an apology to Greenland has not really been a big issue so far. It's there once in a while, but it's not really claimed the same way. Greenlanders have other issues with Denmark, and they have a lot of issues, but the apology is not the most pertinent one, so that could be one reason. But whenever it comes to the definition of a colony, then Greenland comes up, and we have this staunch debate right now, and I'm participating in it myself. It's two historians versus 20 historians, I would say, on whether or not Greenland is a colony or not. Was a colony or not?
And you're pro, right?
No.
Oh.
Yes, yes, I am. Greenland was definitely a colony until 1953. There's no doubt about that. But we have two historians going public all the time saying the opposite, and that has a lot of consequences. I meet it when I speak to high-ranking politicians. The other day I was in a room with Bernd Porter, who's sort of the chairman of the parliament right now. He used to be until recently. He was until recently. Anyways, he's a high-ranking politician in government until recently. And he said to me, yeah, you know, this is a super interesting. He has read my book. This is super interesting. And then he spoke to the public and saying, one thing is the Danish West Indies, but another is Greenland, of course. And Greenland was never a colony. And he said that just like that. And one of my colleagues who's also working on the Arctic and politics, a high-ranking professor of political science called him up to comment on an article, a comment he had said to whatever newspaper that Greenland, there was of course all these colonial issues, right, on an informal level. And Uffe Ellemann wanted, he's our former prime minister, foreign minister, wanted to stress that Greenland had never been a colony. Of course, all this has to do with the fact that Greenland is right now in the process of wanting to become independent. And this is something which is really dividing people both in Denmark and in Greenland, but also creating a lot of tensions on a very high political level. Because of course, the importance of Greenland in the Arctic region, but also, of course, because of the many ties between Greenlanders and Danes. So this is not a, it's a very complex process to all involved. And this, of course, means that the view of the past is affected by that. And this is why we have that. Greenland was never a colony debate, I think. But it is often in a separate track. Sometimes they merge, but it's not always. I don't know.
Some last question?
Yeah, we all know that the debate on the excuse was very heated in Denmark. But I heard on the television that the people on the islands, most of them didn't really care. Is that true or is that not true?
I think you should speak, ask the Virgin Islands. Seems
like responding to that.
We do care. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. We care. The problem is how we show it. And this year for the centennial, you know, and I said it previously at another session. If you looked out, and I was mistress of ceremonies for this year's centennial at home. Well, for the past, I don't know, 7 or 8 years. And I looked out when I got up there to stand and welcome everyone and greet them. And where were our people? It was filled with Danes. The Danish people were in full force. And on Sunday morning when we went to church, the church was filled up in the choir loft. As the organist, I could barely get up the steps. It was filled with Danes, and I was in awe. Where were our people? They did not all come out. Now the elders came out, but the young people did not. And we were wondering, we care, we know we care, we need it. But they weren't there.
The parade.
Oh, the parade. The young people definitely were in the parade. Weren't they exciting? Yes, for sure. Thank you for that.
Thank you. I agree. As a Virgin Islander, sixth generation Virgin Islander, we care. But there, as Dr. Haptee says, indicated, we show it in different ways. And perhaps, I was there. I was there, and I was glad I was there that day because there was a display of history unlike anything else I've ever seen of the people of the Virgin Islands. But we show it in different ways. And some may have not been to the transfer ceremony because it was their way of saying we care and we're not going to see what we want to see.
And thank you so much, Astrid.